Hi, this presentation builds on a previous one that explored frequency distributions, and here we're going to be examining some other ways to display our data through graphs and other displays. And so the first thing we're going to look at is the stem and leaf plot, and we're going to be examining the same data from our previous example in the other presentation, which is a class of students of various ages taking a statistics course, and there are 30 students in the class. The stem and leaf plot looks like this, where we've taken the decade of their age here, 10, 20, 30, 40, and 50, and over here we've got the individual years within those decades. So we've got 3 8s, 3 9s, we've got 2 0s, 3 1s, 2, and so on. And so these are the 20-year-olds, these are the teenagers, these are the 30-year-olds, those the 40-year-olds, and those the 50-year-olds. We can also display the same data using what's called a dot plot, where each data entry is plotted with a point above a horizontal axis. And that looks like this. And again, we could see the 18-year-olds, the 20-year-olds, the 30-year-olds, and then so on. You could see it, as you'd expect, the higher frequency at the lower ages of a college classroom, and then it trails off as you get to the older ages. Next, we can look at the pie chart, which is a circle divided into different sectors that represent the different classes or categories. And the area of each sector is proportional to the frequency of that category. So here we're going to use a different example. We're going to look at accidental deaths in the U.S. from 2002, and we're going to look at the following categories to do so. To create a pie chart, you need to first find the relative frequency of each category. So here we have the relative frequency expressed as proportions. Next, because a pie is a circle which has 360 degrees, if we want to adjust that 360 degrees by the relative frequency, all we have to do is multiply it. So 0.578 times 360 gives us 208. 0.162 times 360 gives us 58.4. and so on, and this will give us the angles we need to construct our pie chart. And here's the final result, and it's a nice way to display the relative frequency of our data. So you can see the majority of accidental deaths are due to motor vehicles, followed by falls, poisoning, drowning, fire, ingestion, and firearms. Next, we can look at the Pareto chart, which is a type of bar graph, where each bar represents a frequency, and the bars are ordered in a decreasing order. And so here's that same data of the accidental deaths in a Pareto chart, with again motor vehicles showing up as the highest category, followed by falls, poisoning, and so on. This time, however, you'll notice we're looking at the raw frequency number, not the proportion of the relative frequency. Thus far, we've been looking at univariate graphs and displays, and now we're going to shift to bivariate, where we're looking at data for two different variables displayed in the same graph or chart. So we're going to start with the scatter plot. The scatter plot is used when each entry in one data set corresponds to entry from another, and the sets are called a paired data set. In the scattered plot, the ordered pairs are graphed in a coordinate plane, which you probably remember from your geometry class. The scatter plot is used to show the relationship, therefore, between two quantitative variables. And here is a scatter plot showing the relationship between absences. We always have our independent variable on the x-axis as a predictor of our dependent variable in this case, which is the final grade. So does an increased rate of absence lead to a lower final grade? This would suggest, in a very linear sort of way, that the answer is yes. So we could see that graphically here using this scatter plot technique. Another bivariate chart is what we call the time series chart. And in a time series chart, at least one of the variables will be a measure of time. So in this case, this example, we're going to look at months, and the variable we're going to be graphing is the amount of minutes used on a cell phone by Robert. And here's our graph. So we could see Robert's cell phone minute usage was rather high in January and February, declined in March and April, had a slight uptick in May, and then went back down in June. So this is a good way to examine trend lines, and that's what this would be called. Anything if we have 3 points or more, we can call that a trend line.